mighty quiet in the house tonight. He says it's 2 minutes. Why don't we go ahead and get started? We'll just let it start when it starts. Everybody come up and let's sing out of the Blue Mull Book. I'd rather be 2 minutes early.
278. 278.
Almost gone.
42. Then the choir can go down, unless we sing some more.
There will be a happy meeting in heaven, I know. When we see the many loved ones we know here below. Gathered on the blessed hilltops, spirit hearts all aglow. That will be a glad reunion day. Glad day, it's a wonderful day. Glad day, it's a glorious day. There with all the holy angels and loved ones to say. That will be a glad reunion day. There within the holy city, we'll sing and rejoice. Praising Christ, the blessed Savior, with heart and with voice. Tell him how we came to love him and make him our choice. That will be a glad reunion day. Glad day, it's a wonderful day. Glad day, it's a glorious day. There with all the holy angels and loved ones to say. That will be a glad reunion day. When we live a million years in that wonderful place, basking in the love of Jesus, beholding his face, it will seem but just a moment of praising his grace. That will be a glad reunion day. Glad day, it's a wonderful day. Glad day, it's a glorious day. There with all the holy angels and loved ones to say. That will be a glad reunion day.
I can just see them walking on the shores of heaven, praising the Lord and watching the tide roll in. Friends who have gone on, oh how I miss you so. And somehow I know if you could, you'd let me know that you're doing fine, it doesn't hurt anymore. Things couldn't be better, and heaven is worth waiting. that you miss me too. Until then, you'll be waiting for me. And I know if you could talk to me now, here's what you'd say to me. Wish you were here, it's such a beautiful place. Wish you were here, nothing but clear sunny days. It never rains and no one complains. We haven't seen a tear. We're having a great time. Wish you were here. I can just see them walking on the shore together. They're talking with Jesus, safe and secure in His love. Friends and loved ones walking in heavenly peace. And I know if they could talk to me now, here's what they'd say to me. Wish you were here, it's such a beautiful place. Wish you were here, nothing but clear sunny days. It never rains and no one complains, we haven't seen. We're having a great time. Wish you were here. It never rains and no one complains. We haven't seen a tear. We're having a great time. Wish you
uphold God's search through heaven. He couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed, that would buy eternity. Had it not been for had it not been for May's come out Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for men, oh Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost,
had it not been for man,
oh Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost.
I want to thank everybody for that beautiful singing tonight. Turn it over to Brother Cale.
Amen. It is good to be back in God's house tonight. I do also appreciate the good singing. Just thank God for His goodness. Thank Him for His love and mercy and forgiveness and saving grace. And I just want to thank Him tonight that He knows all things. And when things are not good, God's still in control. I was thinking along those lines really all day and thinking about the service tonight. And I had asked Ashley to sing a song, and she's going to hear just in a little bit. But I got a two or three places in Scripture that I want to share with you. And it's just proof that, you know, God's in control always. And if we love God and serve Him, just like Romans 8:28 says, let me just read that. We all know Romans 8:28, but I want to read it, and then I'm going to share some examples in God's Word. But we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. All things are not good, but all things work together for good to those that love God. And I'm thankful for that tonight, because a lot of times things are not good. We know that. And I, a long time ago, I marked in my Bible there in Romans chapter 8, and it's 28th verse, I wrote Joseph down right there. And I do want to read some about Joseph tonight. And maybe if we stand, and I'll read a verse over here in Genesis. Genesis, if everybody will stand, Genesis chapter 50. And I want to read just a couple verses here, three or four. Genesis chapter 50, verse 15. And we'll share this with you, and then we'll have prayer and go on into the message. But it says in verse 15 of Genesis chapter 50, "And when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said, Joseph will peradventure hate us, and will certainly requite us all the evil which we did unto him. And they sent a messenger unto Joseph, saying, Thy father did command before he died, saying, So shall ye say unto Joseph, Forgive, I pray thee now, the trespass of thy brethren and their sin, for they did it the evil. And now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of thy father. And Joseph wept when they spake unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face. And they said, Behold, we be thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, Fear not, for am I in the place of God. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we just thank you tonight, Lord, for your blessings and goodness. We just thank you that you're in control of all situations, Lord. If we just love you and serve you, Lord, you're going to take care of us and bless and meet our every need. And Lord, many times things are not good and we don't understand different things that are going on, Lord, but we know, we can know by your word and examples in your word that you're in control, and we just keep our eyes towards you and be thankful for that, Lord. And just pray, Lord, tonight that this word will give us everyone hope to serve you and trust you to the best of our ability. And Lord, we do pray tonight if they'd be one here that never accepted you as their Lord and Savior, they'd see that need. Lord, that you're good and you're in control, and Lord, you can save us and forgive us and give us hope of eternal life one day after a while. And we just thank you and praise you for that tonight. And we just thank you for each one you've sent our way and pray you'd bless them for their efforts here tonight. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. As I read that scripture right there, and especially read that last verse, and I thought about this, I've thought about this for years about Joseph and his situation there, and I'm going to go back over and read just a little bit about Joseph in a minute. But Joseph said, you know, his brothers come to him there, his father had died, Jacob had finally died there, and Joseph, his brothers come to him and they said, you know, Daddy told us whenever he was gone, you'd probably pay us back for all the evil that you did. And he told us to come to you and bow down, you know, because of what we did to you. And Joseph said, you know, I'm not God. He said, but I can just tell you that God was using what y'all did to me for the good. And I thought, that's the way it is. God will use things that may seem bad in our life. And we'll read about Joseph just here in a minute. But they wasn't nothing good. Went on against Joseph. It was seemed like it was all bad, but he trusted God, and throughout his experience, 13 years it was of bad, throughout that, the key phrase in it was God was with him. Okay? God was with Joseph. Turn with me, if you will, back over to Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37. And it said, this is the beginning, really, of talking about Joseph. At this point, Jacob had had his sons there with the different wives. They was the 12 sons of Jacob. And it said, and Jacob dwelt in the land. This is Genesis chapter 37. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob, Joseph being 17 years old. Y'all remember that, 17 years old. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. And I don't think Joseph was a tattletale or nothing like that, but he just come back and told his father what the brothers were doing, and evidently it wasn't good what they were doing. And they found fault against him for doing that. We'd read on down through there, and I want to cover a whole lot of ground, so I'm going to talk a little more than read. But we would read down through there that Joseph, we would find, was his father's favorite son. He was, I believe, there from Rachel, and these others were of the other wives that Jacob had, and he was a son of his old age. And he loved him. It said, now Israel, that is Jacob, he loved Joseph more than all his sons, because he was a son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. We remember that coat that he made, a special coat there for Joseph, and the other brothers didn't get that. And then, so there was a lot of jealousy and animosity against Joseph there. And then we would read on down that Joseph dreamed these dreams. And I studied Joseph, and I've read about him a whole lot, and I don't find anything really wrong that Joseph did, but he shared these dreams, and it was not for his advantage when he shared these dreams, that he had envisioned his brothers bowing down to him. And boy, that did set him on fire when he said, I dreamed a dream that y'all are going to bow down to me. And they just hated him even the more. And then he dreamed a dream again. It says that he found his brothers bowing down to him. And not only his brothers, but his mom and his dad bowed down to him. And these dreams come to Joseph, and he shared them with his family there. And of course, it upset them, and they thought, well, he thinks he's better than us and all this stuff. And so they hated him even the much more. But these dreams, they were visions that God was showing him of how things was going to be, because that's exactly what would happen later on in his life. But we would read on down. And it said that his father sent him out to check on the boys again down there where they were taking care of the sheep. And as they saw him coming, maybe he was going to carry them some food or whatever. And as they saw him coming, they said, there he comes. We'll just get rid of him. once and for all. This dreamer, this fellow that thinks he's better than we are and all this, and we would read down through there that one of the brothers, his name was Reuben, he didn't want them to kill Joseph, and he made a way that they said, let's just throw him in this pit. Let's don't kill him. Let's just throw him in the pit and leave him to die. And that's what they decided to do. They threw him in the pit. They took his coat of many colors off of him, threw him in that pit, and they were going to leave him there to die. Take that coat, put some kind of blood, sheep's blood all over it, take it to the father and say, well, here we found this. Does this belong to your son? You know, we found this. He must be dead. Well, to come to find out, we go on down through there, and Reuben had a plan to go back and rescue Joseph out of the pit, but it said that Reuben was gone, and the brothers saw a group come up from Egypt, come along, and they sold. These other brothers, they sold Joseph down into Egypt to be a slave, and when Reuben come back, Joseph was done already gone. And it said there, you know, I'm wondering what's going on through Joseph's mind. You know, this is going on, but God was with him, it says. We probably know the story, but I'm gonna share it with you anyhow. It said Reuben come back, and he was upset because his brother was gone. They went then, and they told this lie to Jacob, said, we found Joseph's coat. He's been killed by some wild animal, no doubt. And it said Jacob went into mourning and all that. But nevertheless, you say, that's a bad thing happened. In God's word, it was a bad thing, but folks, God meant it for the good, okay? Just keep on. We got to stick with God. He goes on. It said that Joseph was took down there, and he was sold as a slave down there in Egypt. And I'm just going to pick up, if you want to read with me, in chapter 39. It said that Joseph, in chapter 39, was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, I skipped chapter 38. 39 here, though. Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, brought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Remember that. That's throughout this word, the Lord was with him. No matter how bad things seemed, the Lord was with him, and he was very prosperous, a very prosperous slave. He sure was, because God was with him. It said, and the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian, and his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house, and all that he had, and he put it into his hand. And it came to pass from the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well-favored. So God allowed Joseph to be sold by his brothers as a slave, and he allowed him to wind up down there in Egypt. Now, this is over a long period of time. What I'm going to read about tonight is over 13 years of, I thought, over disappointment and troubles and trials that come Joseph's way, but it was all to bring about good, okay? And Joseph, we don't hear no complaining out of him. We don't hear no pity parties or nothing like that. It just says that God was with him, and it said that everything Joseph did, God made that to prosper. And he found favor in this fellow named Potiphar. He found favor. Potiphar was his master there, and it said he found so much favor that Potiphar put him in charge of everything. He was in charge of everything. He said whatever Potiphar had, he didn't even know what and all he had, because he put it all into Joseph's hand. And you think, well, Joseph, God's taking care of Joseph. He's blessed him. He's doing good. This is going to work out good. And then, though, and I won't read this down through there, but verse number 7, it says that after a while, and we probably know the story, but after a while that Potiphar's wife got to looking at Joseph and lusting after him, and she said, you just need to be mine, and you need to go and lie with me. And Joseph said, not going to do that. Not going to sin against God. Not going to do that. And it said that she just kept on, and she kept on, and you'll not find, I've not found anywhere where Joseph did wrong. Now, I know there's not no perfect person. I know that we've all sinned and come short of God's glory because His Word says that. I don't find nowhere, though, where Joseph did wrong, and I'm sure he probably did at times. But in this matter right here, we can see, he said, I'm not going to do that because that would be a sin against God. And she kept on, and she kept on. And Joseph, I always thought about this, Joseph trying to do what was right got him in more trouble. Okay? Joseph trying to do what was right got him into more trouble. He said, I will not lay with you. And when she grabbed him, she caught him there one day when it was just him in the house, and she grabbed him, and he left her standing there with his jacket. He fled the scene. And that's another message in that. When sin comes knocking, we need to flee from it. Okay, or we'll mess around and be caught up in it. But he fled, and it made her boiling mad. Boy, she was hot, and she went and told, said, look, that old Hebrew said he's tried to come on to me and tried to take advantage of me. Just exactly what hadn't happened. She made that up against Joseph, and you know what happened then? It said that Joseph got thrown into prison. As good as he was there, it got, and I've read that a lot of times, and I thought, trying to do good and trying to do what was right in God's eyes got Joseph thrown into prison. But verse 23, and I'll go ahead and read that. Or let me just jump back to verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of, you know, as I read that, and I'll read a little bit more just in a minute, but I got to tell you while I think. When God's in control, and I thought, boy, that was pretty good, but God didn't have Joseph where he needed him just yet, okay? He was getting Joseph where he needed him to be, and that's why all this bad come. It was bad things, but it was working out to be something good, okay? It was bad things, but it was working out to be something good, and God didn't have him where he needed to be just yet, but he's getting him there. The Lord was with Joseph. That's the theme throughout this, is the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed Joseph's hand to all the prisoners that were in the prison. And whatsoever they did there, he was the doer of it. The keeper of the prison looked not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with him. And that which he did, the Lord made it to prosper. So a common theme in Joseph's life was God was with him, and everywhere that he wound up, he was made to prosper. And he was in prison, though. He was still in the prison. But listen now, it was right where God needed him to be, okay? And look at the big picture. It was right where God needed him to be. Chapter 40, I'll just kind of summarize, but we would read chapter 40, and just so happened in chapter 40 that there at the prison, there was a couple people brought down there to jail. It just happened to be a servant to Pharaoh. Okay? Pharaoh there in Egypt was like the president. He was the man. He was as high as you could go. And a couple of servants of Pharaoh's was brought down there to the prison. One of them was the butler. One of them was the baker. And they were put into the prison. And while they were there, now we'll remember back that Joseph had some history with some dreams. And the dreams that he had shared there with his brothers and his family that made them so upset. But anyhow, while he was in, these two men were in the prison, these two men, the baker of Pharaoh and the butler of Pharaoh, they had some dreams, and they told Joseph about their dreams, and Joseph interpreted the meaning of those dreams, and one of them was going to be put to death, and one of them was going to be restored to his job for Pharaoh. And sure enough, you read down through there, I'll just jump into verse 22. But he hanged the chief baker as Joseph had interpreted to them, yet did not the chief butler remember Joseph, but forgot him. The story was that the chief baker, I don't know what he did, but nevertheless, he was put to death, and that's what Joseph interpreted out of the dream. But the butler was restored to his position, and if we would look back, Joseph said, now you're going to get restored to your position, and when you do, remember me and tell Pharaoh about me. But it says that he went back and the butler was restored to his position, but he forgot. He forgot about Joseph. And we'd think, boy, he missed a chance right there. Somebody that could have maybe pardoned him and allowed him to get out of jail for doing something good, but he's still in jail. But you know what? God was still with him. And God didn't have it. It didn't have everything worked out just the way it needed to be just yet. but he's a getting there. So the baker, the baker, he's done already dead. The butler, he didn't remember Joseph, but chapter 41, and I won't read, but I'll just tell you, it said that then sometime later, 2 full years, it says, 2 full years later. Now, you say, Joseph, he was in a bad shape for a long time, 13 years. 13 years this was going on, but God was with him, okay? God was with him in all these ups and downs. God was with him in every bit of it, and God had a plan, okay? But nevertheless, these 2 years passed, and then we would remember the story that Pharaoh went to having dreams. And Pharaoh had these dreams that I believe it was the 7 cows. They were 7 big old fat cows. And then after that, then they were 7 real skinny cows, just bone piles, skin with bone with skin stretched over them pretty much. And the bony, slender cows come along and eat up the fat cows. And that's basically what it was. I'm just trying to paraphrase to help us ease along into this. But nevertheless, they was corn, same way, the big corn stalks with big old full ears of corn and grain. And then they was some that didn't amount to anything. And they came and ate up the corn stalks that were full of grains. And Pharaoh was troubled by these dreams. Nobody could figure out what they meant. And, you know, 2 years later, the butler had forgotten Joseph. But 2 years later, he said, hey, you know, I remember when we was down there in the jailhouse, there was that Hebrew boy that can interpret dreams. He said, maybe we ought to get him to come up here and interpret these dreams. And it said that, sure enough, he remembered Joseph, and he brought Joseph up there to Pharaoh. And Joseph said, yeah, I can tell you what those dreams mean. He said, it means there's going to be 7 years of plenty. In other words, everything's going to grow and do real good. But after that, then there's going to be 7 years of famine. So what you need to do is you need to save up while you've got crops are doing good. You need to save up all you can and be ready for the 7 years that's going to be lean when there's not going to be anything. And Pharaoh was so impressed by this and that Joseph had it figured out right there. Verse 38 of chapter 41, and Pharaoh said unto his servants, can we find such a one as this, as a man in whom the Spirit of God is? He said, can we find anybody whom the Spirit of God is in like this fella? And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as God hath showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. Thou shalt be over my house, and according to thy word shall all my people be ruled. Only in the throne will I be greater than thou. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, see, I have set thee over all the land of Egypt. And jump down to verse 36. And Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went throughout all the land of Egypt. So we get all the way down there 13 years later. Started out with a 17-year-old boy. Now he's a 30-year-old man. And he is basically what you'd say nearly the most powerful man in the whole world right then, as he become basically the vice president down there or maybe you could say the prime minister there in Egypt. He's in charge, and it says he was in charge there as the 7 plenteous years. He made sure they stored up all the grain they could, and then when that famine started, they was ready to take care of themselves and really the whole world, because that famine was a widespread thing. And we'd read on down through there then, and we would see that the famine wasn't only in Egypt, it was up there where Joseph's family was also. And we'd read where Joseph's family, Jacob said, boys, I heard there's grain down there in Egypt. Y'all go down, and we know the story. The brothers went down there, and Joseph recognized them right there. If you went down there to get grain, you had to see Joseph. They didn't recognize Joseph, but he recognized them. You say, how'd they not know their brother? I mean, he was a boy when they seen him last. Now he's a 30-year-old man, 30-something-year-old man, because 7 years has passed of good, and now it's into the bad part where the famine is, but he's an older fella, and we know how he messed with the brothers there. He sent them plenty back and forth, and then he revealed himself, and that brings us to where we was at there in Genesis 50 there a while ago. We know the story. He brought his brothers, his family, all down there, and they were preserved alive. And that's what he said right there. He says, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass that it is this day to save much people alive. You know, Joseph being where he's at, pretty much God saved the world. Okay? Pretty much God saved the world right there from hunger by putting Joseph where he was at. You know, and I think about, and I've heard messages and things comparing Joseph to Jesus. You know, there was a lot of things in Jesus' life was bad and things that he went through, but he went through those things for us to save the world. And, you know, I thank him for that. But everything's not going to be good, but everything's going to work together to good for those that love God and are called according to his purpose. And God was with Joseph. As I thought about that, I thought, you know, when things don't go as we hoped and things and disappointment comes our way, we need to remember that God's still good and God's still in control. As I thought about Joseph, I thought about over in the book of Job. You can turn with me if you want to. But over in the book of Job, it said, and I think, you know, a lot of times it would be hard to have faith like Joseph did and just to keep on trusting in God and knowing God was with him. I think it'd be hard to have faith like Job did. But we would read about Job over here where he lost pretty much everything of his physical possessions that he had. It said he lost his 500 oxen. He lost his 7,000 sheep. He lost 3,000 camels. He lost his sons and his daughters, 10 children that he had. And verse 21 of the first chapter of the book of Job, he said, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." And in all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Then he went on, and it said that his health was stricken after he lost everything. And in chapter 2, chapter 2, verse 10, his wife said, "Y'all just curse God and die." But chapter 2 and verse 10, but he said to her, "Thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What, shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all this did not Job sin with his lips. You know, he said, God give, God take away. You know, he's going to trust God. It wasn't good things that happened to Job, but then we could look over to the end of the book, and I think God gave him about double what he started with when we look over to the end. I thought about the Hebrew boys there. If you want to turn with me, and this will be the last spot I turn to, but if you want to turn with me over here to Daniel chapter 3, I thought about these boys when I thought about, you know, when things are not good, God's working things for the good. Here in Hebrews, or Daniel chapter 3, and I'll just jump right over here to verse 17. But we know the story there in Babylon. There was the evil king Nebuchadnezzar, and he made this statue, and he said, "Everybody's got to bow down and worship this statue of me, and whoever don't bow down and worship this statue of me is going to be cast into the fiery furnace." And it said there was three of them, there, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said, "We're not going to bow down to that statue of you because we serve God, and we're not going to bow down to you." And he said, "Well, we're going to throw you into the furnace." And he said, "I'm going to give you one more chance." In verse 17, they said, "If it be so, our God," he said, "you know, if you throw us into that furnace, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not," he said, "but if he don't deliver us out of thy hand, O king, but if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." They said, even if he don't deliver us, we're not going to betray God. We're not going to bow down. We're going to do what's right. And we would read that, boy, he got hot too. He was fuming hot. He said, heat up the furnace hotter than it ever has been. And he throwed them in there, and it said the fire had no power over them boys. It said there was one in there walking with them, likened to the Son of God. I believe it was the Son of God walking there with those three Hebrew boys. And, you know, Nebuchadnezzar saw that, and when he brought them out of there, he said, "We're going to make a proclamation that there's no other God except the one of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." So, you know, what seemed like really bad brought about something good there. He made that proclamation that people would worship and serve the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But things is not, you know, always good, but God's got a plan, folks. And God is with us, and God will bless and meet our needs. You know, I don't know what might be going on in your life or what kind of encouragement you might need, but tonight, you know, God's able to bless and meet our needs. He's with us, whatever. He's working things for our good. I'm going to ask Ashley, she'll come and play that song. I've been thinking about this song, just as kind of going through my head, and I just thank God that He's in control and He's able to do all things. I'm going to ask you to stand. If God spoke to you for any reason tonight, maybe this song will speak to you. I'm satisfied of that. You know, if you need to come and pray and talk to God, or you know, these things happen, and we'll say why, and we may not know why. I'm pretty sure Joseph probably didn't know why he was going through all the stuff that he did, but he come to a point that he did know why. It was because God was working out a bigger thing. So here tonight, I don't know your heart, but you might need something you want to come and pray to God about, something you want to come and thank God for here tonight. Whatever the need may be, as she sings, you just do what God puts on your heart. There may be somebody else you need to encourage. Maybe you've been going through something. Folks, we can know if we love God and put Him first. He's got a plan. He's in control. He'll bless and meet the need. He's working out maybe something bigger than we can see. She sings another verse. As these pray, you ought to come and talk to God. Maybe you want to come thank Him for something here tonight. Whatever He's put on your heart. Word. You know, everything, I hate to say it, but everything's not going to be good. But if we trust God, everything will work together for the good. And I thank Him for that. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else got something you want to thank God for or make mention of? Else. I appreciate you being here tonight. Hope and pray you've got something and been blessed for being here. I hope and pray you have. Nothing else to be said, though. I'm going to ask Jason if he'll dismiss us in prayer, and then you'll be free to go. I'm going to ask the guys, deacons, if they'll greet you at the door. I'm going to stay away from everybody tonight. And I don't like to. I like to shake people's hand and hug their neck, but again, I don't want nobody saying the preacher give me some kind of epizootics. So, anyway, we'll just hold off again for tonight. So, Jason, dismiss us in prayer, and then you'll be free to go.